Thanks a lot, Mr. Narsimhan. What I heard is, in summary, it's not one solution. It is about the access to cheap debt funding on one part, and on the second part, consistency in terms of the policy rollout, and in the third part, a cover in terms of insurance. So three things is what you brought in. I would now like to ask Mr. Mohan Kumar, that what do you hear, sir, from most of the people who approach you? What is it that they look for in terms of increasing the investment pace in the state and in the country?
Basically, I'm an officer from power sector. I'm from KPTCL. I, as a load dispatcher, definitely do not want more and more solar generation, because of the one simple reason. By evening 4, 4:30, 6 o'clock, the total solar generation is off. My peak is happening 6 to 9. In addition to accommodating peak load, you will have to accommodate whatever the generation you have lost from solar category. So any given time, the generation from the solar, you cannot treat it as an installed capacity. You can only treat it as additional energy input to the country, input to the state. So in this particularly, a load dispatcher will have a tough time to handle the grid between evening 6 to 9, wherein our solar generation totally disappears. I'm not giving this is the only reason one should not have solar generation. Solar generation is a clean energy, green energy, which will not add anything to the climate change. And as sir said, we have more than 300 sunshine days per year with a solar radiation more than 6 kilowatt hour per square meter. With this ample opportunity, definitely we have to add 100 gigawatt of installed capacity in solar generation in the country of India, but parallelly, you should have a generation from other category to meet my evening peak between 6 to 9. That is what I wanted to say.
What I would just add on here is, in a sunny and a windy day, there are lots of times when Germany did about 30% of its total requirement from wind and solar. And exactly what you said happens. So gas-based power is on standby, and gas-based power is the only one that can quickly ramp up to cover the uncertainties and the vagaries that comes from this. I guess storage in the next 2 to 3 years would become affordable and cheap. And when that happens, large-scale battery storage as well as gas-based power generation, which in Indian context is a little uncertain because the resources are not so very available, could probably become something that can work in tandem with solar energy to smoothen it out. So from a perspective of accelerating the deployment in the country, what we did here so far is, there is a technical limitation that if solar crosses a certain value into the grid, then it brings in infirm power, and that creates instability in the grid. So that is one issue. That is typically about 30%, I guess, of the grid. Yeah, about that value. We are right now far lesser than that as a country, which means there is still a margin for India to catch up to reach those levels. Yeah. So still there is a time for India to reach there. So what does it take? Mr. Narasimha was mentioning that access to money is one of the prime reasons. Is that the only reason? Has it got something to do with certainty on policy? Walk the talk, as what Mr. Raman mentioned earlier, the policy consistency, predictability, and assurance. So I would like to ask you, Mr. Raman, what are the other ingredients into this? And from a financier's perspective, why is it that non-recourse finance, which has been the prime driver for renewable energy deployment in other countries, has really not taken off to such a large extent in India? What are the reasons?
Far too many answers. I would simply put it that way. I have an uncertainty in regard to the policy of the government. I have uncertainty in regard to the price of take. I have an uncertainty in regard to whether the transmission is going to be at a particular rate. Okay, you come along and say that between generating and transmission, we have brought it down from 0.46 to 0.18. Does it really happen? See, as a banker, I find it very difficult that I start the project. Typically, a project would take 18 to 24 months to complete, all other things being in place. But if I were to start with assumptions of your days of 22, factor in something like an NTPC JNVL kind of scenario of 14, and then ultimately end the day with 347, I really don't know whether this project, after 2 years, will not see a second problem coming up in terms of dropping power prices. Number two, the uncertainty of the DISCOMs in actually off-taking the power. Right now, a warning bell has been sounded by sir when he said, I need a standby power as a load dispatcher. While agreeing to that, I would look at consistency in offtake. I wouldn't want the government to give a guarantee that they will offtake 10 megawatts and not offtake anything, thereby preventing the producer from either selling it to somebody else, because he's already committed. And if you keep dropping prices every second day, in fact, about 15 days ago, somebody was very vehemently arguing for a common pricing for power. Power is power. So why should I treat solar power differently from thermal power or gas power? Let's put it all at 2.47 rupees. If I put that, there is no way a solar power project is going to be viable. Added to that is the fact that I've got, our lead speaker had already said this before. Honorable XMP sir was mentioning this. When he came along and he said, the state of the DISCOMs, okay, luckily Karnataka is not under Uday. But those under Uday, I'm not very sure whether their financial health is going to be maintained over a period of time. This could be a band-aid solution. Like what, maybe 5 years later, 7 years later, we find ourselves in the same kind of a thing. Instead of dealing with 20 DISCOMs, we are dealing with one per entity. That's all. So there is a huge amount of uncertainty. The bankers are not very comfortable with the letters of credit that DISCOMs give. Because we also, like Saab said, we also do not know whether what happens 3 years later when the LC actually comes for payment. So these uncertainties have to be addressed, and have to be addressed by the rulers of the day having the foresight to be able to implement a particular policy with a certain amount of certainties built in. We have seen the river project and the amount of guarantees that have been incorporated into the agreements, which gives a lot of strength to the investor. I would consider a banker to be an investor, akin to an investor in industries like this, because these are long generation projects. I can't expect a solar to have a door-to-door tenor of 3 years or 4 years or 5 years. I would like to go up to 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. That's the way we are looking at it. So my take would still be that the policies have to be clearly defined. And if the policies and the tariff being a part of it, offtake being a part of it, evacuation being a part of it, if these are clearly defined, I do not see very much of a hindrance on the part of difficulty on the part of bankers coming forward in funding these kind of projects. That would be the take of, I think, all bankers. And IBA also has a core committee for clean financing, clean energy funding. State Bank of India has gotten $625 million from the World Bank for funding rooftop solar. Money is not a constraint. Money is not the constraint. Policy is.
Thank you. Thanks a lot for this. So what we understand now, when from the investor, Mr. Narasimhan, we heard about the need for money, and also we heard about the technical limitations of what a grid can take, and thankfully there, we still have at least 25% more to go before we reach a saturation, by which time the storage would have probably stepped in and eased it out. On the money side, what we are also hearing as a continuation is policy consistency and predictability. Predictability in terms of deployment, the next 1 year's roadmap of how the policy is going to be, when the tenders are going to be announced, and to stay there and not change it. That is one part. The second is not to have the renegotiations of PPAs done as what was attempted recently, but thankfully the government intervened in that also and stopped it. So that is a very positive sign. The other part is the part around the viability of the whole thing. So in continuation of that, there is also a sentiment that a new emerging technology always has an inherent uncertainty, always has an inherent risk. If we start looking at the year 2010 and 11 as a classic example, the prices of photovoltaic modules fell 48% in a matter of 9 months in that period. No amount of modeling, no amount of prediction, no amount of logic would have made us understand these kind of market movements. Trade-related anti-dumping investigations that are happening in a country like the US right now suddenly led to a scarcity of modules all over the world, including India, in the last few months, and also had an increased price as well as a limited inventory issues coming up. So it's an interconnected world completely. From a manufacturer's perspective, how do you see India had dominance at a point of time in manufacturing in terms of solar balance of systems and the modules, but today there is an attempt to regain the dominance, let's put it that way. So how do you see the manufacturing side contributing in this mix to accelerate the growth of the Indian deployment of renewable energy?
Thank you, sir. Thank you. If you see the manufacturing, it is going through a continuous change. I'm sure my fellow OEMs in this dais and in the hall would agree. That is, we are going through a very a rapid change, wherein if you see any technology per se, there is a 10-year cycle, we would say, where the technology is introduced, and for the 10 years, there is an adoption of the technology, and then you move on to the second gen and the third gen. But what normally happens in an ideal technical or a technology-oriented industry, whereas thanks to the adoption level of solar, what should have happened in 10 years is happening in less than 5 years. So that is a continuous change. The speed at which it is changing, we Indian manufacturers per se should adopt to the speed of which the change is happening. For example, if you see, the entire world is now talking about 4 busbar and 5 busbars in the modules, and people are already, Germany is already perfecting monocrystalline PERC based cells, and they are talking about module efficiencies above 16 to 17%, and even higher with PERC cells. And the Japanese manufacturers are already moving to 1,500 volt inverters. So the speed at which the international market is moving and the speed at which the Indian manufacturers, that's all of us, are moving, there is a delta, which there is always a running race where we are running, and there is a small delta when you compare Indian technology with the international technology. This is one factor. And the next factor is, like you rightly pointed out, sir, before 2008 or 2009, the Chinese manufacturers didn't have their silicon foundries, up and running. So many of the German foundries and the Taiwanese foundries were actually supplying the silicon needed for the Indian manufacturers. This was way back in 2008, and I'm sure many of you would agree. Then what happened was, all of a sudden, China decided to erect almost three foundries, one of the largest in the world. And three of the major foundries, silicon foundries, are in China, which is supplying the rest of the world, I can say right now. And we have one major foundry in Taiwan. So all of this actually accelerated the ingot output from which we all as Indian manufacturers take the ingot and do the cells, and then we call it our own cell line, or we buy the cells and then do the module manufacturing. While India is still at the 3 busbar and 4 busbar, we are already moved on to the 5 busbar systems. So this is somewhere which, in a technical front, we as Indians need to get back into the dominance. That's one way. And the next thing is, I would also like to touch upon Sir's views, where the grid management is a very critical scenario. No matter how efficient modules you're going to put there, with tracker, with a single axis tracker or a seasonal tracker, whatever the case may be, you're still, though you have PLFs or CU, PLF of even 21%, which is the magic figure right now, still the grid management is a problem. When you talk of a quantum of more than say 20 megawatt or a 10 megawatt, you're obviously, your evacuations have to be on a dedicated front. So when you're talking about a ultra capacity solar farm, you're talking about a 1,000 megawatt or a 2,000 megawatt solar farm, obviously you have your only option is to evacuate it to the green corridor. We are talking about 110 kV plus kind of evacuation levels. Then comes the grid management. Like you rightly pointed out, sir, at 6 o'clock, all our power plants are going to get closed. So what happens? So on a technical front, technology front, there should be a mix of, say, coal-based or whatever is the current conventional-based, and a mix of on-demand where solar can come in. And like Santosh rightly pointed out, energy storage on utility scale is on the corridor. So these deltas, wherein you need your peak between 6 p.m. to 8 p.m., where is your peak demand, where solar can definitely not supply. Energy storage is another way of looking at it. And Germany has already had a very successful business model of pumped storage, which is still doable. I know water is a problem in India, but still, pump storage can be of use, which is, so what we see is in a technology front, if India, with all the technical know-how, in fact, Indian brains, one of the, I'm a proud Indian, okay? So Indian brains are one of the most smartest brains, so with all the know-how what we have, all we need to do as manufacturers is quickly adapt to the change what we are going through right now. Because solar is already come to a very mature and I would rather say a saturation level, where you cannot push the module efficiencies more than this unless we adopt PERC technology very immediately in the next 1 year. Please correct me if I'm wrong. What I see is PERC is going to be popular maybe next year, but till such time, these efficiencies where we are talking about grid curtailment can be avoided. And when we start off avoiding grid curtailment and availability of power on demand, we are looking at a very mature policy, because we are talking about stored power being pumped back into the grid. So that requires an altogether new treatment on the policy per se. How are you going to treat a power which is going to come out of a lithium ion battery after 6 p.m.? This is a question we are going to look at maybe next year or next 1.5 years. Then comes the reliability itself. Though the lithium ion is talking about 30 years of design life, we are talking about modules for 25 years, and here we have lithium ion based or any chemistry, lithium polymer or whatever it is, lithium ferrous or whatever the technology may be, we're still talking of 30 years of life. So it is going to be as good as your modules over there. So how exactly is the PPA going to be a treatment? And how exactly the DISCOM going to look at stored power being pushed into it? And there is a shortage of quality coal, which all of us know. and we are chasing dollars, you know. And there is a problem, you know. Next, I would like to also touch upon the commercial issues. You know, the cell prices have increased by almost 2 rupees. I think all of you will agree. The currency has increased by 1 rupee. What was at 64 is at 65 steadily for the past 1 month. And the next thing is we are addressing 5% dumping on tempered glass, which you know, most of us are importing. Or if even if you buy it from any manufacturer, we are looking at 5% accelerated, ADD, that is your dumping duty of 5%. So this is another problem we are having now. So this has increased the module price also. So now comes the financing viability itself. See, what was X price, X plus 2 rupees on these factors, which none of us have any control, has increased the module prices significantly. And still it is safe to say that more than 60% of the power plant cost is the modules. And you are already looking at a 2 rupee increase. So the viability per factor comes into a play. One is your tariff, which you have already bid at a very low price. Now dollar is against you. Even if you do an hedging, how much are you going to hedge? I really don't know. But still, dollar is against you, and you have an anti-dumping put on the tempered glass. On this, you have grid curtailment, and the grid curtailment which is happening. And then the next issue is some of the PPAs don't have a deemed generation clause. This is the next issue which the bankers also, or the DISCOMs also, would have to consider very seriously. So I would like to cut short for want of time, but I think I covered the issues. Thank you, sir.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot. I would like to, at this stage, before passing to the other two panelists, summarize what we have been hearing. So on one hand, investors look at financing as the key source. From a financing aspect, certainty in policy, certainty in terms of deployment is the key hurdle to enable financing. Money is there, but using the money is becoming a hurdle. From a manufacturing perspective, what I hear is we are a little behind the curve on technology adoption compared to the rest of the world, one part. And also probably volumes volume of manufacturing and the scale of manufacturing also is a hurdle. That's why the price points are also not being able to reach what international market is. Uncertainties in terms of the dumping duties, uncertainties in terms of policies is something which a new market always goes through. Yeah, it's part of the birth and the growing pains. And what also happens, and this is also interesting, banks always look at de-risking. There are other sources of finance that are risk friendly, they like risk. Yeah. So if you look at what is happening on solar also, to a large extent, these monies are coming into the country today. Because an inherent nature of a new economy that is growing up is uncertainty. It takes time for everybody to get their act together. Yeah. From a point of view of distributed decentralized that you touched upon in terms of storage, I would now like to ask Mr. Satish Kumar, who was instrumental in many ways to launch the policy itself in the first place, how do you see the rooftop market, the distributed decentralized market, contributing to the overall growth in the country, first part? And the second part is, the rooftop market is already at grid parity. Industries and commercial establishments can get solar energy at least a couple of rupees cheaper than what the utility can sell them at. Yeah. So is regulation in terms of open access or net metering approvals coming in the way of deployment of these policies, and what should be done to increase this? Over to you, sir.
Hello. Yeah, the rooftop as it is picking up well in the market. I think now BESCOM itself has added around 60 megawatts. More than 500 installations have been already commissioned. But as we were already discussing that there has to be a consistent policy. The policy itself, a series of guidelines and orders have been issued by the commission as also by the utilities, which has not only confused the stakeholders, but also the consumers and also the bankers. The bankers are reluctant to finance, as was discussing, because there is no proper consistency. But all these things are evolving now. I can say that the things are almost settling. And actually the commission, when it introduced the first time the policy in the year 14, it was one of the best policy. And none of the state had given what you call a net metering tariff of 9.56. And even though the tariff have, they have reduced it to 7 rupees and dot for 10 kilowatt and below, it's still one of the best I can say for the whole country. See, 7 rupees, for especially for a domestic, the utilities are charging something like less than 6 rupees. For commercial, actually, it works out because, the tariff prevailing is somewhere around 7 rupees and all. With tax and all, it comes to like 8 rupees. So, especially for commercial, whether it is a small, you have a small roof or a bigger roof, it's still viable. And even for the apartments, all the apartment, the association can come together and have a roof on their buildings so that their maintenance charge also, it can come down.
Is rooftop is already a free market. It's a market which is on demand supply. There are a lot of new concepts coming in energy like blockchain. Blockchain, for example, permits a factory in Peenya who don't work on Sunday to sell the energy next door to somebody only for one day, yeah, not on a long-term PPA. There are certain hurdles today. Open access, getting open access permissions is becoming one of the largest hurdles in distributed, decentralized deployment of solar. How do you see and what should be done, in your opinion, to accelerate this?
Yeah, this block open access is applicable only to megawatt scale. For a rooftop on kilowatt, this open access is not there. So rules doesn't permit. And selling energy, because he has some excess energy on a particular Sunday, that cannot be allowed. It is not allowed as per the prevailing rules. But under net metering, he can always sell the energy, whatever the excess energy is there, to the grid. I don't think there should be any scene or a problem to a customer, because under net metering allows for that. So whatever excess is there, you give back to me. I'm the utility, I'm there, I'm going to consume, and you can bank whatever your excess energy is there, and you can always draw it whenever you are in need. So that is already taken care. So giving back the energy to your next neighbor and all, we'll make the rules a bit more confusing. Now already we have seen many confusing orders, I can say.
Understand. Thanks a lot for that. So what I hear is that the net metering anyway is available. Utilize that, dump the excess energy. And in terms of people using the rooftop solar, utilities are not discouraging it in any way. Open access is another matter which I think needs some specific attention at some point.
That is for a megawatt. And anyway, if you don't want that, you have a grass metering. Option of grass metering is there for domestic and other category of installation like hospitals and all. So you don't want to touch the grid. Whatever you generate, you simply dump it to the grid. You get at whatever is the defined tariff.
Sure. Thanks a lot. Last, I would like to ask Mahesh on one important subject. In all developed economies, financing, which starts from venture capital, private equity, fund-based, family fund, trust fund-based financing, eventually has to move into pension funds via the route of debt funding, through institutional debt funding. India is at the cusp of this happening. Yeah? Now, from a point of view of non-recourse, there is also an element that comes into picture, which is about quality of the installation itself and quality of the products used. Certain financial institutions worldwide typically have in-house assessors of quality. The in-house assessors are not agencies that are hired deal per deal from outside, but they are employees of a financial institution, looks at the product quality, looks at the engineering quality, assesses it, and then decides whether a loan should be given, and if so, what interest rate it should be given. Poorer quality, higher risk, higher interest, lower tenure. So that way, what happens, it encourages quality to come into the market. Mahesh, you are one of the largest EPC companies in India and outside, and you have been doing projects both in India as well as internationally. How do you see the appetite for quality among equity investors in the Indian market? And what do you think should be done to improve the quality of the assets? Because most of the assets that are coming in India are coming for reselling in one way or another. Most of the companies are going for IPOs to sell the companies to public. A few of them are in the secondary market to sell the assets itself to others. Assets can only get sold if assets are bankable and have a requisite quality inside them. So what is your experience in terms of quality consciousness and what should be done to improve it?
I'll begin with this 100 gigawatt target that has been set. Mr. Santosh has clearly told that we have achieved 17 gigawatt installed capacity now. That puts a lot of pressure. Another 5 years more, I think it gives us a target of more than 15 gigawatt per annum, which is itself looks though realistic, but unless all the stakeholders come together, there is a lot of challenges. What we have achieved for the last 3 years, though it's comparatively, it's a very good achievement if you go back to your decade, old experiences, what Mr. Santosh has said. But looking at the way things are moving for the last couple of years, we see certain bottlenecks which needs to be addressed. First of all, I would like to address the first major issue what Mr. Santosh has put in. One is assessment of the quality. Now, coming back to the whole pressure building up, now as I think the financial point of view, what was put in forth was like the sort of pricing which are coming in. Ultimately, they want to know how that is executed. Okay, we have last, I think, couple of months, I would rather put it, wherein especially the PPA, the prices, the sort of pricing what we are seeing is sort of putting a lot of pressure on EPC players and even project developers. I think there is some sort of pressure on developers because they need to be in the market and they need some portfolio, both on private front and utility front. Even utility, we saw, I think, a 2 point something which is going in Gujarat recently. Yeah, and more astonishing was what happened in Dubai, UAE. I think that was like quite at an international level. That was really shook us. I think we thought it's only in Indian market we are facing this, but it's going across the globe. Now, first of all, to address now, I would rather put it that the first thing what the developers who are interested in portfolios is like have an in-house. Sort of a technology team which can have the realistic assessment of what's happening. Okay, first of all, so that would not put a pressure on your in your quoting. And the second most important, because as Ms. Santosh was emphasizing, here we are seeing more debt which is coming from equity, family-based funding, which is like wherein we are seeing that just a few couple of people, we have had couple of inquiries where they would have hired some consultants and they very clearly tell that we don't have anything in-house. And we want an established player to do that by themselves. See, as an established brand across the globe and even in India, yes, we have all the capabilities to do it, but on a different perspective, I would suggest that should this equity-based, fund-based companies should develop an in-house team which can assess the quality. When you are comparing, when you are awarding a contract, an EPC, or when you are bidding for a project, so an in-house evaluation would really help. I would rather emphasize on this because we are seeing that in most of the cases, what we are talking to, especially the equity-based companies, they have only the benchmarking. I need this price. Are they themselves satisfied that is it workable with that price? That's the biggest challenge. Yes, and in the market, what is happening? As Mr. Santosh put it, most of them are going for public selling or secondary market where they are looking at selling the assets. That itself is, I think, I would rather say that is really not so encouraging for the market. The quality aspect is not at all taken care. In a different perspective, they have some, they would put in a tier one or certain terms, which is like, which they feel that themselves take care of the quality aspect, but that is not the case. So I would once again say that most important thing is that the fund-based or equity-based, which is probably that is more attractive. As from the banker point of view, we are seeing that, and the developer point of view, I'm sorry. They are looking at people who can partner them. They are more to do with who can share the risk.
That happens only if it is an equity-based or a family-based or debt-based, wherein this is very important for the market, because we are what the target we have set in. I think it's very important that we get a different type of funding mechanisms. I think India should, as a country, we should also sort of develop wherein we create a platforms as such funding fund-based companies who can be able to access the developer, vice versa, both sides, which will enable a better and stable growth. That's one part. And I just like to add few more points in terms of EPC perspective, what we are facing. The one major point is the land. I think in India, land is gold, or gold is land. Land acquisition in some part, as a developer, I think sir would also agree that though there have been mechanisms put in place, but that is really taking a lot of time. I think the sort of, because in solar projects, we are looking at very shorter timelines, which is really affecting in terms of land availability and land acquisition, especially in states where there is a huge demand for the land. And the second part is evacuation. I think sir, as CREDL has really put forth, we are, as an EPC player, we look forward to some sort of a mechanism where a dedicated corridors can be built. It has been experimented. PGCL wanted a green corridor. In some solar parks, it has been built. But more than that, even if there is a, because if we have got 20 megawatt blocks, 50 megawatt blocks, wherein a sort of a stable policy in terms of evacuation, okay, well, in sort of dedicated evacuation or the grid available will really help. And the third most important thing is storage. I think when we say solar power, the most important aspect comes is like what after six. I think as UV, I would like to add that we are very keen on this new technology business. We have in fact executed one of the most important, probably it's one of the bigger ones in the world. We have done a 6 megawatt storage in Australia. It's for a copper mine where we have tried to, it has got both hybrid as well as storage capacity. Out of 10 megawatt solar PV what we have installed, we have got a 6 megawatt storage capacity. And we are looking forward that, we are feeling that there's ample growth for storage in India. Yes, I think the storage costs, we are seeing that for last decade at least, the costs have been coming down. And we are very hopeful and confident that storage and the hybrid models like solar and wind or solar and gas based. So there should be some sort of growth in this market, which will really help renewable energy to reach this target. That's what I have right now. Thank you, sir.